Christian Audio presents You Don't Have to Try So Hard, Ditch Expectations, and Live Your Own Best Life, written and read by Kathi, Lipp, and Cheri Gregory.
Just try harder used to be our motto. No one would ever label me a perfectionist. You can't eat off my floor. Well, you could, but I wouldn't suggest it. My husband would say our house is cluttered enough to be comfy. I can fall asleep with a basket of unfolded laundry in the next room, and no part of me admires Martha Stewart. As many of you know, however, perfectionism comes in disguised and sneaky forms. I've spent a lifetime caring what complete strangers think about me. I have to fight thoughts of unworthiness every single day, and I have a hard time believing I should be allowed to enjoy anything in my life. Everyone else is so much more deserving than I am. I also have this constant feeling that everyone else gets it, whatever it is, marriage, parenting, work, friendships, God, and I don't. It is a struggle every single day of my life, feeling like I'm out of the loop, that everyone else was handed some kind of manual to life. And while I may not look like the classic perfectionist, the hurts that come from my behavior when I'm living by the beliefs of the bully of perfectionism are just as destructive. I will pick up the check in almost every situation because I feel that I've taken up the other person's time. I will run out the night before an event and spend too much on clothes so that I appear to fit in. I spend 10 times more time worrying about how other people feel in situations than being concerned about my own health in these relationships. It's a fine line I walk. I want to put other people's needs ahead of my own. I'm the drowning woman who is throwing life preservers to people on the lifeboat so they will have something to rest their heads on in their deck chairs. Perfectionism isn't Christian. It's just crazy.
And I would never have labeled myself a perfectionist. When I was a teenager, my poor mother, who kept an immaculate house complete with white sofas and carpets, often told me, "Just looking in your room, I feel messy." Shortly after I got married, my mom came to visit. She took one look at the sad state of my housekeeping and told my husband, "I'm so sorry. You have no idea how hard I tried." I never saw myself as a perfectionist because I couldn't keep a spotless home like my mother did. But it turns out that trying hard was something my mom and I had in common. We just tried hard at different things. The "just try harder" mantra made me a student who argues for the extra point when she gets 99% and who cries if her A has a minus. A teacher who skips family gatherings because she can't face her students until her lesson plans are just right. A wife who tries to overhaul her husband so she can finally have a happy marriage. A parent who explains the latest unforeseen circumstances to her children's teachers dozens of times, even when they're in college. I tried as hard as I could, but I still failed, which I defined as getting a lower grade than I wanted, hearing criticism of any kind, being publicly humiliated, feeling foolish, you get the idea. So I started following a secret second mantra: don't bother trying. Playing it safe turned me into an employee who doesn't speak up during staff meetings so her input can't get shot down. A woman who automatically thinks she's not going to like me when introduced to someone for the first time. A friend who lets a call from a best female friend in crisis go to voicemail because she feels too inadequate to answer. A pastor's wife who skips church because her own family drama has left her too drained to put on her game face for the day. A daughter who didn't visit home very often because she couldn't fix her mother's Alzheimer's disease. I've exhausted myself trying hard when it really didn't matter, and I've not tried at all when it actually did, which are the major symptoms of try-harder living, with or without white carpet. Even though we have different life stories, we've both succumbed to try-harder living. We used to look for the nice, polite ways to follow God's call. We caved to others' expectations for too long. We finally decided to stop taking our cues from the world and start asking ourselves, what does God want from me and have for me? We've come to this conclusion. There is no nice, polite way to do this. There's no easy way to leave the life that's been expected of us and to start living the brave, not so neatly tied up life God is calling us to. We have to rebel. We have to make choices countercultural to our society, our families of origin, and even our churches. We're guessing that as you've listened to our stories, you've said, "Me too," at one point or another, or perhaps at several points. Most women we know are fighting try-hard living to some degree. We get it. We've been there. We have the souvenir travel mugs. And because life isn't perfect, those mugs have leaked all over our shirts. It's the official uniform for the recovering perfectionist. A nice white shirt with a huge stain down the front. Come join our rebellion. We have cupcakes. The frosting is a little mushed, but hey, they still taste great. They aren't homemade, but we're okay with that. As we share our own rebel stories and strategies, we hope you will exchange outdated views of who you should be for a clear vision of who you are in Christ. Take control of that too long to-do list so it no longer controls you. Stop striving to maintain an image and live with more freedom day to day. Overcome the tyranny of more and live radically with the abundance of enough. Stop trying to earn others' approval and learn to rest in God's lavish, unconditional love. Neither of us could have walked our journey or written this book alone. We needed each other. Ecclesiastes 4, 9-10 tells why. Two are better than one, because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Find yourself a buddy who's ready to learn how to be her own kind of brave too. Then come join us at Rebel Headquarters, www.youdonthavetotrysohard.com. We are all in this journey together. Part 1. Say so long to try harder living. If you suspect you too suffer from an undiagnosed case of try harder living, you may be wondering, how do I know if it's time for me to rebel? If so, exactly what do I rebel against? How do I become a rebel? We'll answer all these questions and more, but first, a quick diagnostic test. Rate each of the following statements on a scale of 1 to 5, with a 1 signifying that you strongly agree with the statement and a 5 signifying that you strongly disagree. Be sure to write down each of your answers to find your total score at the end. 1. I'm flexible about how things get done, my way, your way, either way. 2. I'm willing to try, fail, and learn from my mistakes. 3. I allow myself to feel big emotions from anger to sorrow to joy. 4. I know how to appropriately process and express negative emotions. 5. I have plenty of chances for fun, recreation, and celebration each month. 6. I regularly get 7 or more hours of sleep per night. 7. I take responsibility for my own feelings and reactions. I expect other people to take responsibility for theirs. 8. I'm secure in my identity as a child of God. I love my family, friends, work, and hobbies, but they don't define me. 9. I make a point to keep my home, calendar, and life uncluttered. 10. I'm intentional about budgeting and balancing my space, time, energy, and money. 11. I ask for help as soon as I need it. 12. I'm comfortable declining invitations and requests. I communicate pleasantly and confidently when doing so. The ideal range on the Try Harder Living test is 12 to 24. We're guessing if you're listening to this book by choice, your score is higher than ideal. 25 through 36 is mild Try Harder Living. 37 to 48 is full-blown try-harder living, and 49 to 60 is severe try-harder living. How do you know if it's time to rebel? If you're stuck in try-harder living to any degree, the sooner the better. Try-harder living worsens exponentially when left untreated. If you're just at the mild stage, praise God and rebel while it's still an easy choice. The longer you wait, the harder it gets, because the four troublemakers that cause try-harder living are parasites. They are hell-bent on dominating your life. Their goal is to destroy any sense of self you have left. Chapter 1. Meet the bullies of try-harder living. Try-harder living has four main instigators: perfectionism, people-pleasing, performancism, and procrastination. These bullies work together. When you're fighting with one, the other three cheer him on and jump in as needed. Although each bully has his own special weapon, they all share one common goal: to convince you to pour all your energy into creating and maintaining an image. This image is based on who they say you should be. Their criteria, of course, change from day to day. This keeps you dancing to their demands, right on the edge of burnout. To break free from these bullies, we need to know a bit about them. Forewarned is forearmed, after all. In this chapter, you'll discover how to identify each one, and you'll learn how to recognize the strategies they use against you as they aim to paralyze you with try-harder living. Perfectionism. I'm always trying harder to look good enough. A quick question to ask yourself if you suspect you're getting hammered by perfectionism is, am I obsessed with getting certain results? If your answer is yes, perfectionism is the likely culprit. If you listen closely, you can hear him yelling, "That's not good enough! Try harder!" Let's agree right up front that when we use the term perfectionism, we are not referring to conscientiousness, becoming more like Christ, a commitment to excellence. Perfectionism is characterized by relentless criticism of self and others. Comedian Ken Davis puts it this way: a perfectionist is not someone who is perfect. It is someone who is miserable because they can't get it right. People-pleasing. I'm always trying harder to seem nice enough. Am I obsessed with getting specific reactions? Is the question that will help you catch people-pleasing meddling in your affairs. This bully assures you he has your best interests at heart and is just trying to help. They don't look happy yet. Try harder, is his motivational mantra. People-pleasing is not the same thing as love. In many cases, it's a major cause of the erosion of love. Nor is people-pleasing the same thing as care, compassion, sympathy, or empathy. People-pleasing involves putting the wants of others above one's own needs, avoiding conflict, basing self-worth on others' reactions, feeling trapped by others' needs, often to the point of martyrdom, keeping silent about one's own needs, wants, and opinions. People-pleasing has been called the disease to please. At its core is a chronic craving for others' approval. Performancism. I'm always trying harder to be seen doing enough. If you ask yourself, am I focusing so much on this project that I'm neglecting key people in my life? And get the response, don't worry about them, they'll be fine. You're being bossed by performancism. He'll also insist, keep working, there's lots more to do. Performancism is not the same thing as a strong work ethic, nor is it practicing a skill to mastery. Just as workaholism is not merely working hard, but an actual addiction to work, performancism is a compulsive, insatiable craving for achievement. Performancism tells us performance will result in love. That's backwards. Love always leads us to take action, but performance, on its own, can't produce love. We can fake it till you make it with some things in life, but not with love. Procrastination. I know I'm not enough, so why try? Procrastination is a master of misdirection. If you start to wonder, am I so worried about the end product that I'm neglecting the process? Then procrastination will quickly refocus you on the end product. He'll use a magnifying mirror that causes the end product to loom so impossibly large that you can think of nothing else. Procrastination is not the same as reflective thinking. Many of us need time to ponder important issues and choices. Procrastination is not ignorance. When we don't know what we don't know, we can't even ask a question that would get us unstuck. This can look and feel like procrastination because we're not making progress, but it's not. Procrastination is the practice of doing what is less urgent but more fun before doing what is more urgent but less fun. The kinds of women these bullies like to pick on. Did one or more of the bullies seem frighteningly familiar to you? If so, you're not alone. When we speak about the four bullies of try harder living, women make a beeline to tell us, "Me too." We've talked with stressed out, overwhelmed women who are trying too hard to do too much. Discouraged, guilt-ridden women who feel like failures because nothing they do ever feels good enough. Self-defeated, embarrassed women who overpromise but underdeliver. Resentful, isolated women who try to keep the peace and make everyone happy while their own needs go unmet. Dedicated women who sense a barrier between what they're doing and what God wants from and for them. Family and friends of women being beat up by the bullies of perfectionism, people-pleasing, performancism, and procrastination. New Christian women taking their first steps on the path of spiritual maturity and eager to do it all right. Women who have been in the church for decades, publicly wearing the perfect Christian persona while enduring the private torment of shame over secret struggles. Pastors' wives and female pastors who live under the microscope of the entire congregation, with every choice subject to criticism. Women in leadership roles that demand more and more, subtly eroding boundaries and balance in the name of doing the Lord's work. Women in ministry whose motto is just try harder as they try to camouflage the ineffectiveness caused by trying to be all things to all people. Stay-at-home moms who are urged by society and even family members to prove their worth by doing more than just raising the children and keeping house. Working mothers who feel guilty for leaving their children and try to make up for it when they're home. Women in transition because of a sudden life change, injury, illness, loss, or entry into a new season of life, who are wrestling with altered external and internal standards for measuring up. Women who serve as role models to youth and want to break free from the bullies instead of unconsciously teaching their beliefs to yet another generation of girls. Women who are, or have spouses who are, in the military, law enforcement, firefighting, EMT work, and other fields that require perfection and performance to such a high level that these demands spill over into personal and family life. Do any of these women sound at all like you? How about some of your friends? These women helped us realize that we have to rebel because try harder living is killing us. We can't go on pretending it's not. As you've seen in this chapter, perfectionism, people-pleasing, performancism, and procrastination aren't just harmless, lovable quirks. They're bullies with a death wish for each one of us. But take heart. Their MO is predictable and obvious, and your weapon against them is the most powerful in all creation. You don't merely have a chance at beating them. Victory is guaranteed. Chapter 2. Take your first brave steps. Fear, love, and a reality check. A teacher we know assigned his high school seniors to write an ethics paper. They were to outline their personal values and give specific examples. The next day, one student raised an important question. "I claim to value certain things, but the way I live is different from what I say I believe," she said. "Which should I write about? What I say I value or how I actually live?" Do you find yourself in the same quandary, knowing that in your heart you embrace one set of values, but finding that in your day-to-day life, you're often living by other, perhaps more expedient values? Just for now, until this crisis is over. Assuring yourself that when everything gets back to normal, you'll return to your core values. As you listen to the following values list, write down W for anything you say with your words that you value, and L for anything your life consistently demonstrates that you value. In some instances, you will write down both. 1. using my abilities. 2. Taking risks. 3. Being a lifelong learner. 4. Treating people with respect and kindness. 5. Having fun. 6. Participating in hobbies and recreation. 7. Staying healthy. 8. Acting with personal integrity. 9. Living in the present. 10. Making a difference. 11. Reaching goals. 12. Experiencing career satisfaction. 13. Being a good steward of what God has given me. 14. Caring for the environment. 15. Establishing financial security. 16. Living a balanced life. 17. Spending time with family. 18. Enjoying intimacy with my spouse. 19. Building a strong marriage. 20. Loving God. 21. Being a volunteer, participating in community service. 22. Nesting and creating a home. 23. Attending church. 24. Reading God's Word. 25. Being a good friend and having close friends. In the areas for which you circled both W and L, your stated values match your lived out actions. You have integrity in these areas. But what about those areas for which you circled only one or the other? These are likely to be areas of conflict, stress, and anxiety. When you say you value something but don't back up that belief with action, or you claim not to value something but participate in it, you live in hypocrisy. Yes, we know hypocrisy isn't a pretty term. It sounds awfully judgmental, but hang in here with us. We know if we're pointing at you, three fingers are pointing back at us. Did you know the original meaning of hypocrite is actor? Someone who plays a part that really isn't her? That's what we feel like when we claim one set of values but live by another. Inauthentic. Phony. Fake. If you sometimes feel as though you're living someone else's life, maybe it's because you are. Hypocrisy causes us to negate who we truly are, who God made us to be. The try-harder living bullies demand that we live according to priorities we don't really believe in, and they cause us to violate the values we do. When we let them be our guides, they lead us off course, straight into deep and destructive behavioral ruts. Once in, we don't realize that we should get out. How do they wield this kind of power over our lives? They use fear. The bully's number one weapon, fear. Fear is at the heart of try-harder living. We all experience fight, flight, freeze, or fawn instincts. And while your individual set of panic button pushers is unique, we are all susceptible to four universal fears. 1. Fear of pain. Pain includes physical and emotional, actual and anticipated, my own and others. Perhaps a friend's unexpected criticism hurts your feelings. Or your back tenses up as you realize cramps are starting and getting worse by the minute. Or you feel your child's disappointment over not making the team as if it were happening to you. 2. Fear of loss. The threat of loss permeates our lives. Most obvious is the fear of death, losing your own life or losing someone you love. Loss of a dream can feel like a small death. You may know what it's like to lose your health, to feel perfectly fine one minute and be ushered into agonizing pain the next. If you're like us, you've lost more relationships than you care to count. 3. Fear of blame. It's all your fault is the clarion call of blame. When hit with blame, we often juggle and pass it on as fast as we can. Perhaps you fear being blindsided by the fallout from accidental mistakes or discovery when you've knowingly done something wrong. Guilt and shame typically ride shotgun with blame. 4. Fear of shame. Shame is the sense that we're not worthy of love and belonging. Shame says not only are you alone in this world, you deserve to be left alone. You are simultaneously too much and not enough. You're defective. You haven't just made a mistake. You are a mistake. Fear enslaves you to the bullies, compelling you to behave according to their beliefs instead of your own stated values. Love, the core choice of becoming your own kind of brave. Love is at the heart of becoming your own kind of brave. When we're battling fear, the last line of this familiar Bible verse about love can be downright terrifying. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. 1 John 4:18. As the bullies of try-harder living push us to make ourselves perfect, we might misinterpret the phrase, "the one who fears is not made perfect," as condemnation straight from the Word of God, evidence that we're beyond all hope. This verse, intended to help us overcome fear, can have the opposite effect. The truth is, God wants to unlock the chains of fear, freeing us from its power. The New Living Translation offers a slightly different interpretation of 1 John 4:18 that is both compelling and comforting. Such love has no fear because perfect love expels all fear. If we are afraid, it is for fear of punishment, and this shows that we have not fully experienced His perfect love. Fear isn't proof that we're hopeless for not making ourselves perfect. Fear is simply a warning sign that indicates we've not fully experienced God's perfect love. What a difference! If the core issue were our failure to become perfect, then the solution would be for us to keep trying harder. That's exactly what the try-harder living bullies want us to believe. But since the real problem is our failure to fully experience God's love, the solution has nothing to do with trying harder and everything to do with fully experiencing God's love. Experiencing and responding to God's love. While we can experience God's love in a myriad of ways, we're not going to take a bag of tricks approach. We're going to stay focused on the core choice we make when being our own kind of brave, the choice to love. The word brave means possessing or exhibiting courage. Courage comes from an old Latin word meaning heart. Becoming your own kind of brave is all about heart, fully experiencing God's heart of love for you and responding by loving God with all your heart. The most important commandment, answered Jesus, is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than this. Mark 12:29-31. The more we love God, ourselves, and others, the more fully we experience God's love. Love God. We love God by actually believing Him and actively obeying Him. How? Jesus spells it out clearly for us in John 13:34-35. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. We actively love God by keeping His commands. John 14:15. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. John 14:21. Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. John 14:23. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love. John 15:10. Love yourself. Loving yourself isn't about developing a supersized ego or being puffed up with pride. God's command to love ourselves recognizes that the degree to which we love or don't love ourselves profoundly influences our ability to love others. We can't give away what we don't have. If we're full of self-hatred, we can't give love. We can give only what we have. Oh, you might say, I'm just harder on myself than anyone else. This sounds great in theory, but when your child hears you muttering, you are such an idiot, when you've made a mistake, how safe is she going to feel coming to you when she's messed up? And when your spouse hears you chewing yourself out because you did the same dumb thing again, why don't you ever learn? How likely is he to approach you to ask for forgiveness for the same old problem? When it comes down to it, who has to listen to your bad-mouthing self-talk the most? You do. As women, what we hear, we take to heart. And what you say flows from what is in your heart. Luke 6:45 NLT. That means our self-slamming becomes a perpetual cycle of negativity, out our mouths, into our ears, into our hearts, and back out our mouths. It's not okay to hate on ourselves. And telling ourselves that our self-abuse doesn't affect others does not mean it doesn't affect others. It does. If you don't believe us, ask someone who loves you how they feel when they hear you putting yourself down. Their answer may surprise you. Loving yourself means first believing God when He says you are right with God, pure, holy, redeemed, 1 Corinthians 1:30. A new person with a new life, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Brought to fullness in Christ, Colossians 2:10. Loved, chosen, holy, and blameless, Ephesians 1:4. Freed and forgiven, Ephesians 1:7. God's handiwork, Ephesians 2:10. Bold and confident, Ephesians 3:12. Chosen and appointed, John 15:16. Justified, free from the penalty of sin, Romans 3:24. Not condemned, belong to Him, free from the law of sin and death, Romans 8:1 and 2. More than conquerors, loved, Romans 8:37. Inseparable from the love of God, Romans 8:39. Loving yourself also means obeying God. Obedience starts with lots of listening. It's the only way you can tell the difference between God's voice and the voices of the try-harder living bullies, not to mention your own internal chatter and all the other people clamoring for your attention. The more you learn to hear God's voice and take Him to heart, the better you will understand what He's leading you to do. Love others. The try-harder living bullies con us into believing that love is a feeling that comes naturally, especially to women. We can trust our instincts, run with our female intuition. We don't need to learn how to love others, and we certainly don't need practice. Love just happens. Anything that involves work can't be love. If we find ourselves struggling to love someone, the bullies even let us completely off the hook. Some people, they assure us, are just impossible. We can't be expected to love them. God makes it clear through His word and His own deeds that love is an act of the will. Regardless of how we feel, loving others means believing what God says about them. This is hard. It's much easier for us to believe what we're currently thinking about them. She's so bossy. He's so stubborn. She's so frustrating. Love is a conscious choice to remember that what God says about us, He says about others too. She is complete in Christ, Colossians 2:10. He is God's masterpiece, Ephesians 2:10 NLT.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.